Hallelujah. Well, if you got a Bible with you, look in Hebrews chapter 2 and Hebrews chapter 9. We're moving right along on this Hebrews project. I don't want to get in too much of a hurry. I want to do it justice. On the other hand, I already know what we're going to do next, so I'm getting excited about that, but it still needs a little work, so I got time. If the Lord tarries, I got enough to keep us busy for years. Amen. Hebrews 9. We'll read chapter 2 and verse 1 through 4 first as our primary text for this study on the book of Hebrews. Verse 1 says, "Therefore we must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? God also bearing witness, both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will." And then we proceeded through the first 8 chapters of Hebrews, comparing the wonder of the Son through whom God spoke in these last days to the arduous nature of the law that was given by Moses and the prophets in the Old Covenant, comparing the wonder of the New Covenant to the Old Covenant forms and types and shadows. We talked about how much greater Jesus is than the angels, how much greater Jesus was than Joshua, how much greater Jesus was than Moses, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, until we got to the high priest, and we started talking about the high priesthood, and the writer pointed out that Jesus is our high priest, all right, but he didn't come from the tribe of Levi, which was problematic because in order to be a priest under the Old Covenant, you had to come from Aaron's family. So, in order for that to happen, there had to be a clause in there somewhere. We found the clause over in Psalm 110, where he said, "I made you a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." And in Hebrews 5, we started talking in some depth about Melchizedek. Learned you probably are the best educated people, at least in Tucson, on the subject of Melchizedek. And about that eternal priesthood, that Jesus is a priest after that order. And we began talking about that eternal priesthood and the wonders of that. But at the end of chapter 5, he told them that they were too stupid to understand what he was trying to tell them because their hearts had become hardened. So he spent chapter 6 kind of getting them straightened out on the basics. This is a very fast recap of several months of work here. But then in chapter 7, he continued to talk about the Melchizedekian priesthood. I don't know if that's a word or not, but it sounds good. And in that chapter, he says some wonderful things about the receiving of the tithes, one of my favorite go-to passages on tithes and offering. But in chapter 8, then, he told us at the beginning of chapter 8, it helped out people who are like me and they're a little slow. You know, we've read 7 chapters and we still don't know what he's talking about. And in chapter 8, he says, "Now this is the main point of the things which we are saying." So I'm very grateful for that sentence. So he let us know. What is the main point then? The main point is that we have such a great high priest. Praise God. Okay, so we spent chapter 8 wandering through the introductions to the priesthood of the Lord Jesus Christ after the order of Melchizedek, that he is a high priest with a new covenant based on better promises. Amen. And then in chapter 9, he began to describe to us, well, the last verse in chapter 8, I'm going to read from the contemporary English version, says, "When the Lord talks about a new agreement or a new covenant, he means that the first one is out of date, and anything that is old and useless will soon disappear." Now, he uses some pretty strong language about the Old Covenant in Hebrews. We've seen several places where he called it vain, empty, useless. But it wasn't vain, empty, and useless when it was in effect. But what's he telling us? It's not in effect anymore. It's now vain, empty, and useless. Amen. So, with that in mind, he then begins in chapter 9 to talk to us about this better high priest that we have under this covenant. And let's see, we talked about types and shadows and the pictures under the Old Covenant that were ours by looking at the tabernacle that Moses made as it was showed to him on the mountain, make it exactly that way. That Jesus was now our high priest, not in that tabernacle that was made with human hands, but in one that was made by God. Amen. Eternal in the heavens. And we talked about some of the signs or the symbols that were inherent in the Old Testament tabernacle. Remember that? We looked at the little pictures of the stuff up on the thing there. And we found that every piece of the tabernacle, the high priest, and all the sacrifices all had significance. Amen? Well, let's begin tonight in verse 11 of Hebrews chapter 9. Read a few verses. Because he's going to begin to talk to us now about not just the high priest, but about the wondrousness of the sacrifices. Amen? And what we can learn from looking at some of the sacrifices in the Old Covenant and how much better the sacrifices offered by our new and greater high priest are than the ones in the Old Covenant. He's going to tell us why they're better. And it's pretty exciting stuff, if you ask me. Verse 11, he says this. He says, "So Christ has now become the high priest over all the good things that have come. He has entered that greater, more perfect tabernacle in heaven, which was not made by human hands and is not part of this created world. With his own blood, not the blood of goats and calves, he entered the most holy place once for all time and secured our redemption forever. Under the old system, the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a young cow could cleanse people's bodies from ceremonial impurity. Just think how much more the blood of Christ will purify our consciences from sinful deeds so that we can worship the living God." Amen. "For by the power of the eternal Spirit, Christ offered himself to God as a perfect sacrifice for our sins. This new high priest enters the real Holy of Holies in the heavenlies," verse 14 tells us, "with a perfect sacrifice, the sacrifice of himself. The blood that he brings is evidence." He's not offering his blood to God as a purchase price or to sanctify the Holy of Holies in heaven. You understand that, right? The Holy of Holies in heaven is not unholy, almost by definition, right? So he doesn't bring his blood in there to clean the Holy of Holies. He brings the blood to give evidence of the fact that redemption has been purchased. Amen. He did this. I'm going to read from the literal translation of the New Testament from Hebrews 9:12. It says, "Nor through the blood of goats and of calves, but through his own blood, he entered once for all into the Holy of Holies, having procured everlasting redemption." Having procured everlasting redemption. There's a small battle that's fought over the couple of translations in this verse, which is why I like to sometimes go to the literal word-by-word translations. Let's see what the man actually said. Amen. Instead of somebody's idea about what they thought he should have said, which is how translations get done often. But he says here that through his own blood he entered once for all. Not once and for all, but once for all, amen, having procured everlasting or eternal redemption. Now, he didn't go in there to purchase eternal redemption. He went in there having already procured eternal redemption. Amen. Now, we want to note several things from this passage, for it's all about this wonderful and better sacrifice going all the way into chapter 10, and we'll look at a lot of that. But notice this, he did it once. He offered his blood once. He came into the Holy of Holies once. He did it for all. I know that seems obvious to us because we're us. But it's not always obvious to everybody. And I've noticed this, that there's a lot of things that seem obvious to me that are apparently not obvious to everybody else. And then sometimes I see things that people say that they're obvious to them, but then I listen to them for a little while, and what comes out of their mouth indicates to me that that's not what they really believe. Because they say stuff that's not consonant or consistent with that particular belief. Are you listening to me? And in this particular case, I think it behooves us every once in a while to remember that the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for everybody. Now, there are people this very night, I could tell you where to go to find some of them, that would fight you tooth and toenail over that statement. Christian people. They say that the blood of Jesus was only shed for the people that are elected by God to be saved. Look with me in 1 Timothy chapter 2. Let's look at just a couple of passages here that I think you really have to have help to misunderstand. That makes a difference in what you do if you believe it that way. Because if you don't believe the blood of Christ was shed for all, then you're going to wind up not being concerned about them poor heathen that it wasn't shed for. You wind up with the mentality that the Jews gathered because they had the law. They thought, you know, we were chosen by God. Come on. And therefore, there's something special about us. Yeah, that's all that's special about you. You were chosen by God because you're kind of a bunch of doofuses. Have you ever read the Old Testament? Amen. He did this once for all. The blood, his life, never has to be shed again and be re-offered. You understand that? Jesus is not running around looking for another dose of blood to take back into the Holy of Holies. He did it once, and it was enough for all. You in 1 Timothy 2 yet? This is very pertinent to our current situation, I think, because it's where he talks about praying for those that are in authority. So let's just start with verse 1 so we'll get that part in here. I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. How many people? All people. That seems pretty clear, doesn't it? Ask God to help them. All people. All people. Not just people you like. Not just people you agree with. Not even just people that are nice to you. It's easy for me to pray for people that are nice to me. God bless them for being nice to me. Amen. But I find it necessary sometimes to pray for people I don't like and that have not been nice to me. Sometimes more so than the other kind. Because people that are nice to me are going to get blessed anyway. Why? Because they were nice to me. The people that weren't nice to me are the ones that need prayer. Why? Because God protects me and they better duck. Amen. So they need me to pray for them. Ask God to help them, intercede on their behalf, and give thanks for them. That one's hard sometimes. Amen. He said, pray this way for kings and all who are in authority. Why? So that we can live peaceful and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. You want to know the will of God for your life? There's a pretty good sentence to describe it right there. Peaceful lives marked by godliness and dignity. I like that, don't you? Amen. Everybody say dignity. In this day and age we live in, you have to take people to the dictionary so that they'll understand what that means. Amen. Pull your britches up. Your underwear is not dignified. Amen. Sometimes the coarseness of people's language in public, does that ever bother you? There are people I just commonly, you know, sitting in a restaurant, you hear, I think, you know, if my daddy was alive, he'd walk over and slap him up the side of the head and say, there's nice people here, be quiet. Amen. Dignity. Ever look at somebody and say, dignity. I mean, it's all right to have a good time. It's all right to be, you know, a happy-go-lucky, I suppose. But my goodness gracious, we don't have to be undignified. We don't have to be just coarse for the sake of being coarse, do we? Amen. Why? Because, number one, this tells us it's not the will of God. Anyway, that's a whole other subject. I guess we better go somewhere else. He said, why? Because this is good and it pleases God our Savior. Okay, we want to do that, don't we? Here's the one we're looking for. Who wants everyone to be saved and to understand the truth. Amen. Everyone. Everybody say everyone. That, to me, that's very hard to make a case for everyone not meaning everyone. Amen. He wants everyone to be saved. Why? For there's only one God and one mediator who can reconcile God and humanity. That is the man, Christ Jesus. He gave his life to purchase freedom or to ransom, the King James says. To ransom who? Everyone. All, everyone. That's twice in the same passage, isn't it? from the mouth of two or three witnesses. Well, I guess it's just one witness saying it twice, isn't it? The word ransom, New King James says, a ransom for all. Auntie Luton Hooper. That helped you, didn't it? That means a price that was paid in ransom on behalf of someone else. Hooper means as a substitute for. The redemption price was paid as a substitute for everyone. Jesus paid the ransom as a substitute for everyone. He took our place, all of us. He took the place of even those who reject Him. Are you listening to me? That's important. Because if you don't believe that, you won't try to reach out to people that you determine in your little pea brain that are not part of God's wondrous chosen people. I don't know about you, but if you've been watching me before I got saved, you would have had to think to yourself, he's probably not one of them. Some of y'all have been holy ever since you was born, you know. But I wasn't. 1 John chapter 2, let's look there. First John, the second chapter. And you remember in 1 John chapter 1, he's been talking about if you say you have no sin, then you're lying. Oops. But in verse 9, he's talking to Christians. He said that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. Chapter 2, he starts out and says, I'm writing this to you so that you don't sin. But then he said, but when you do, he didn't say if you do. That's kind of reassuring to me. Verse 9 has always been reassuring to me in chapter 1 because this is the great apostle John, the apostle of love, the apostle that Jesus loved. And he said, if we confess our sin, amen. We means me and John. Right? So that means John's saying that he's just a guy like me. Amen. Sometimes he fouls it up too. So that's reassuring to me. I don't know about you. Amen. But here he says, but when we do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Verse 2, the New Living says, He Himself is the sacrifice that atones for our sins. And not only our sins, but the sins of all the world. All. Once for all. John chapter 1, think about that one for a minute. Remember, this is the same writer, of course, the Apostle John, when he was describing the events, you know, when he first saw the Lord after he was grown and the Holy Spirit came down, descended on him like a dove. Remember all that stuff? But you remember that great anthem that he proclaimed in the first chapter of John's Gospel. When he saw Jesus, he said, what? Behold, what? The Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of us chosen people. Well, now this is a Jew saying this. You talk about somebody that would mess with their theology to think that the Messiah would come and take away the sins of the whole world. For a Jew to think that was revolutionary because they believe, man, we the chosen folk, and man, when the Messiah comes, he's going to whoop everybody else and set us up. So when John said that, that had to be the Holy Ghost moving in him. Are you listening to him? Amen. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Glory to God. Amen. So I don't know how you misunderstand that. Either he took away the sins of the world or you have to throw away about half the New Testament, which some folks seem fine with. 2 Corinthians 5, let's look there. Get another witness from Paul here. In the letters to Timothy, of course, he was writing to the pastor of the church there in Ephesus, Pastor Timothy. But here in the Corinthians, in 2 Corinthians, he's writing a little letter of encouragement and admonition to the Corinthian church, and they were kind of a mess, to put it mildly. 1 Corinthians, you know, he corrected them for all kinds of stuff, prostitution and that was some of their better stuff. They were getting drunk at the communion service. Wouldn't let the poor people in. I mean, they had some problems, brother. all kinds of strife and division in the church. Some people were preaching that the resurrection was already past. Some people were preaching there wasn't any resurrection. They apparently having services where all they did was speak in tongues. Nobody ever interpreted or nothing. They'd go on for hours. Wonder why people thought they was nuts. And so, I mean, Paul had a big job correcting the Corinthian church. So in 2 Corinthians, he wrote the second letter to them because now they're ready to leave Paul. They decided, we hired us a new apostle. We don't like that apostle because he keeps correcting us. We don't like that. And so they're going to get a new apostle. So Paul was helping them to remember who their daddy was. 2 Corinthians. That's a very loose summation of 2 Corinthians, but it'll work for you. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15, it said, he, talking about Jesus, he died for everyone. Oh, okay. So that those who receive him, or receive his new life, will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ, who died and was raised for them. He died for everyone, so that those who receive, you catch that? He died for everyone, but not everybody will do what? Receive. That seems so simple to me. Verse 16. So we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. Could stop there for a while, couldn't we? We have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. At one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. How differently we know him now. This means that everyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. So, what's he talking about here? We like to take that scripture, of course, and apply it to ourselves, don't we? Any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And then we say, praise God, I'm a new creature. But when he wrote that, he wasn't telling them you're a new creature. He was saying all them other people that you've been judging are new creatures too. That was actually what he was talking about when he wrote the verse. I mean, it's true of you, all right. You can claim it for sure. You're a person, so you qualify. But at the time he wrote that, he was busy correcting the Corinthians about their attitude toward people. Hallelujah. So, this means that anyone, everybody say anyone, who belongs to Christ has become a new person. Old life is gone, new life has begun. And all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. This will make you nervous. No longer counting people's sins against them. Is that in your Bible? Some people apparently have cut it out. And has given us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. So what's his argument here? If I see someone who's sinning, my job is not to yell at them and tell them to cut that out, you lousy sinner, you're going to hell. He said, when I see people in that condition, I recognize that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. And that poor ignorant thing don't know, apparently, that God has paid the price for reconciliation. So what's my response? I plead, be reconciled to God. What's plead mean? Beg. To me, that's just the opposite of what we often see, both in ourselves and in many others that claim the name of Christ. What's the name of that bunch of doofuses that pickets the funerals? Whatever their name is. God's going to get you crowd. You know who I'm talking about? Some kind of Baptist church. I don't remember what their name is. But they're just a radical example. They go to people's funerals, especially soldiers. They like to picket soldiers' funeral. And the whole picket's talking about how they're all going to hell because they let gay people in the Navy or something. God's going to judge you. That's just what I need when I'm trying to bury my loved ones, you know, that gave their life for their country. It's a bunch of idiots with a sign. Well, too often I think we adopt that same attitude. We start getting that little edge in our voice because we get mad at sinners. Come on now. I always think about did you find it? Westboro. I kept wanting to say Westwood. I knew that wasn't it. I remember back in the 1980s, which is sort of a miracle. Anybody can remember that long, but they had the great TV evangelist rift. You know, the folks in Carolina got in trouble for building an amusement park, and then some other people were on the. Remember Nightline? Everybody stayed up at night, and they made $1 billion and $1 billion. Bringing evangelists and different religious people on there and interviewing them on national television so they could all run each other down in public, which I thought, you people don't even own a Bible, do you? And they had plenty of volunteers to come on and run people down on national TV and then wonder why people think Christians are all nutcases. But there was one particular fella that was on there regularly, running down this poor guy that was building the amusement park, you know. And I called him everything but a Christian. And then the next thing you know, he's getting picked up somewhere running around with a prostitute. Oops. And all I could think of, a friend of mine who's a pastor in Oklahoma, as a matter of fact, said at the time, he said, that old boy is so mad about this other guy's sin, you just wonder what he's hiding. You know, and it wasn't just a couple of months later, man, boom, okay, we found out, didn't we? Amen. I always wonder if people get mad at sinners for sinning. I'm thinking to myself, they probably must be mad because they wish they could get away with it. Mad because they can't do it and get away with it. Maybe that's it. I don't know. But I always remember the prodigal son. Remember that? Prodigal son came back after frittering away his whole inheritance, comes back home. And the one in that whole story that you look at that is really the jerk in the whole thing is his brother, remember? He won't even come to the party. Well, I've been here this whole time. You didn't give me no calf. Had a party for me, and the father said, you could add a party anytime you wanted to. Amen. He got that attitude. Well, that's most churches, I think, are kind of like that's the way I always looked at church. Amen. Come on. Amen. If I'm getting mad at somebody for their sin, I always wondered in that story because he seemed to accuse the guy of spending all the money on women. Amen. Well, how'd he know what he spent the money on? Either he was following him around, or maybe he's just thinking to himself, that's what I'd have spent it on if I was spending it. I usually find that people that are mad about it and accusing people of stuff, you better go look in their closet and see what's in there. Come on. So anyway, my point is this. Paul's attitude doesn't seem to be that, does it? Now, he got mad at people that were trying to pull people away from Christ and were preaching heresy. He got pretty uptight with them. Why? Because they're leading people away from heaven, dear friend. Disparaging the name of the Lord, yeah, to the extent that people are actually being impacted for eternity by their wrongdoing. That's a whole other deal. But getting mad at people just because sinners are sinning is not supposed to be our response. What's supposed to be our response? I beg you. I'm begging you. Be reconciled to God. Not I'm going to punch you because you're a sinner. Or I'm not going to be around you. Amen. We got to be careful about letting them sinners in. There wouldn't be anybody here. Well, the flip side works too, you know. People always say, well, I don't want to go to church because there's hypocrites there. I say, well, you just be right in the right place, won't you? Sounds like a club you're qualified for. Come on down. Amen. But our attitude, I said all that just to say this, that if we approach God's attitude, if we look at people from a spiritual perspective, which is what Paul asks us to do here, when we see people who we know are broken and going to hell, if it doesn't break our heart, then our heart's not right. Because the same blood that was shed for you was shed for that person. I don't care what they're doing. Amen. Even that yahoo that's cutting people's heads off on the TV. And it makes me just as mad as it does you when I see it. But I'm thinking, you know what? Jesus died for that guy. Go figure. I would have left him out if it's up to me. But nobody asked me. He went right ahead and did it once for all. Amen. I remember some years ago I was doing ministry in the jail. I don't know what it is about me in jails, but here I was anyway. And I actually went to Victory Christian Center in Tulsa, and they needed somebody to visit the jail, and I happened to have an ordination card so I could get in to the maximum security area in the county jail. So I drew the short straw, so I went up there. But anyway, this one old boy had his mama asked us to go visit him, and she... You know, he'd been raised in church. He knew a little bit about religion. And I went and I talked to him. He's a pretty good old boy. He's a truck driver. But he was separated from his wife. And he went over to, he had a weekend visitation with his little kid. I think he was a son, if I remember correctly. He went over on a Saturday morning to pick up his son for visitation. When he got there, there was another truck sitting outside the trailer they lived in, you know. He's thinking, that's my trailer, that's my wife, that's my son. 6 o'clock on Saturday morning, this old boy obviously spent the night, and goes and knocks on the door, and sure enough, some old guy comes to the door of his house in his underwear, you know. And it was just all he could take. And so he did what any good redneck would do in the situation. He went out to the truck, took his gun off the rack, and came back, knocked on the door again. The old boy came to the door, and he blew him up. Got in the truck and drove off, headed for Canada, and got convicted about halfway there and turned around and came back and turned himself in. But anyway, to make a long story short, I visited him on a number of occasions and led him to the Lord, and went back to visit him every week. You know, we did a little Bible study. One day we were sitting there, and he's looking at me. He just, tears started pouring down his cheeks. I mean, I'm talking about, he is sobbing. Big old boy. I mean, not the kind of fellow you think about crying. You know what I'm saying? And he was just bawling. I said, what's the matter with you? He said, I'm just hoping that I didn't dispatch that poor man's soul to hell. I thought, man, if I could get that attitude in people in the church, I'd have me a good congregation. I got to be on maximum security. See if he's just waiting to find out if they're going to fry him or let him serve life. And his first concern was whether he'd sent that man to hell with that shotgun. I thought, now that's the heart of God. Amen. Glory. Are y'all getting this? Is it going to affect how you approach people tomorrow? That's the question. Amen. It's easy to go, yeah. Something else when you get out and the guy's standing there in the underwear at your house. Come on. I mean, you know what I'm talking about, right? It all depends on whose ox is being gored, is how they used to say that. Amen. Our job is to let our hearts be broken when we see people. Are you listening to me? Who are not going to heaven, who are not reconciled to God, that though the price has been paid, they have not received the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. Why? Because the price was paid for all. He also tells us that it's an eternal redemption. What's that mean? It lasts forever. Your eternal redemptive price has been paid. You have been bought. The only question is, will you take advantage of it? Not only will you take advantage of salvation, but will you take advantage of the other terms of the agreement and the covenant as you continue to walk with the Lord? A lot of people get saved, come to the Lord, know the Lord, headed for heaven, got their ticket punched. But there's a whole lot of other things in the redemption package that they don't avail themselves of. It's already bought. You might as well take advantage of it. I mean, if you're on the cruise, then go ahead and enjoy all the benefits of being on the cruise. The meals are included. Amen. Hit the buffet. It's already done. Eternal redemption. The word redemption, this particular word that's translated redemption, has to do literally with paying a ransom for somebody. Paying somebody to set somebody else free from some sort of bondage. If you look it up in your concordance, it'll say something to the effect of to release on receipt of a ransom. The act of freeing or releasing or delivering. Our eternal freedom, release, and deliverance has already been paid. Praise God. 1 Peter chapter 1, turn there with me if you would. 1 always tickles me because most people just like to read the 19th verse and they forget the 18th verse in 1 Peter chapter 1. Because they don't understand the 18th verse. They usually just kind of buzz over it because they don't have to stop and think about it, what it means. And this is Peter. Peter wrote to Jews by and large. Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles, but Peter talked to the Jews so much he wore the beanie, remember? Paul had to rebuke him for getting back under the law. Here in 1 Peter chapter 1, he says in verse 18, "For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors, and the ransom he paid was not mere gold or silver. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb. God chose him as your ransom long before the world began, but he has now revealed him to you in these last days." Notice verse 8, that we like to take this passage and talk about the precious blood of the Lamb. Praise God, that's a wonderful theme to take, all right? Not with silver or gold, with the precious blood of Jesus, a lamb without spot or blemish. But notice what it says he redeemed you from. Who's got a different translation? What's it say in verse 18? He redeemed you from what? Ooh, I like that. Wait a minute. We want to get that on the recording. Is that the Amplified? Must be. It's 3 or 4 sentences long for 2 words. So. Read that again.
Okay. "For you know that you were not redeemed from your useless, spiritually unproductive way of life, inherited by tradition from your forefathers with perishable things like silver and gold."
Hallelujah. Your useless, unproductive way of life inherited from your forefathers. Who's he talking to? Yeah, he's talking to Christians, all right. But when he says that inherited the traditions inherited from your forefathers, he redeemed you from the useless traditions that you inherited from your forefathers. What's he talking about? Yeah, he's talking about Jewish religion. Your useless religion. Amen. So he's certainly talking to us. He doesn't want us to have a useless, unproductive religion either, does he? But when we talk about being redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, we automatically think of what? Sin. We'll get to that in just a minute. But he's telling them they've been redeemed from the useless human traditions of religion that they had lived in bondage to. They were ransomed and set free from religion. I think that bears preaching on every once in a while. Religious ritual and man's traditions need to be discarded just as surely as your sinful way of life. Hallelujah. Religious exercises, whether they came from the Catholic Church or from the Lutheran Church or from the Pentecostal Church, things that you do simply because you know you're supposed to do it, because it's what everybody does on Sunday, are useless exercises in religion. It doesn't mean they're not okay things to do, I suppose. But there's an awful lot of gyrations we go through that the original reason and purpose for them has long since been lost for most people that do them. A tradition is anything we do the second time because we did it the last time. Now, Paul said there's some traditions that we learn from him, if you read in his epistle, that you need to do the traditions that you learned from me. Why? Because there's some of this stuff that you need to do. But it had to do with preaching the word, learning the word, receiving communion. Amen. But if we're going through motions, just for the sake of going through motions, we've been redeemed from that. We've been redeemed from the threat of religion, that if we don't keep the following rules, we're going to hell. Amen. Now look in Titus chapter 2. If you ever need a good whooping, go over and read Titus. Paul had left him in a situation that I just never envied at all. Apparently the people that Paul left him there to try and straighten out, he said, he told him, I left you here to set some things in order. And you start reading what was going on, you think, that must have been a mess. But apparently Titus was just the kind of guy you needed when a mess was in order. But you read some of the things Paul wrote to Titus, you're thinking, whoa, that's tough, man. Titus chapter 2. Let's start in verse 11. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Amen. The grace of God. Everybody say grace.
Grace.
Now, you know there's a I have people ask me this fairly regularly. Said, that, does your church preach grace? Well, yeah, we're Christians. By grace are you saved through faith. If you're going to be a Christian, you pretty much have to preach grace. But when they ask that, in this day that we live in now, I know what they mean. I call it greasy grace. Amen. Amen. What they mean is, do you believe that Christians are still accountable for their wrongdoing? I don't necessarily think we're going to hell every time we burp, but I also believe that sin still has consequences. And that God don't like it. Then they want to argue about whether or not Christians have to ask for forgiveness or not. Have you been around them folks? They get all exercised about it. So why don't you just go ahead and ask and get on down the highway? Amen. Do you have to repent for being mad at me? I think you should. Anyway, that's for another story. But sometimes I don't think they have these verses in their Bible. It said, the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us, this is the grace of God teaching us. Everybody said, grace teaches us. What does it teach us? It teaches us to do what? Denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. If your grace doesn't teach you that, then it's greasy grace. If your grace teaches you that you can do whatever you want to do and that there's no consequences for it, then apparently you don't have Titus chapter 2 in your Bible. Hallelujah. Say, we love you, Pastor. Thank you. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. He ransomed us, in this case, he says, from every lawless deed. We've been set free from the law, but we have also been set free from lawlessness. Why? Because the grace of God has changed the who we are. And when we live after who we are, the what we want to do will follow closely behind. If your salvation didn't change the who you are and the what you want to do, then maybe you better take another check at your whole card. You know what your whole card is? Somebody don't know what their whole card is. Anybody ever play blackjack? One card down, one card up. The whole card's the one that's down. Nobody else can see your whole card. Or you could be paying five-card stud or anything else that's got a card down. It's the whole card, the one nobody else can see. You can always tell when people are getting nervous about their bet. I already looked at it once or twice, but then the guy throws another chip out there and they go, yes, okay. before they throw any money out there, they want to make sure they saw what they think they saw. Some people need to go back and check their whole card one more time. Make sure they got what they thought they got under that. Hallelujah. Amen. Y'all so holy, I have to explain how to play cards. That's sad. Amen. So he says, he gave himself for us, there's that sacrifice thing again, that he might redeem us, ransom us from every lawless deed, and purify for himself his own special people who have a desire. They're zealous. That means there's a passion in their heart to do what? Good works. You understand that good works doesn't mean not doing stuff, right? Come on. Good works means doing good stuff for folks. Amen. If you check your whole card and you find a card down there that says anything about being self-centered and selfish, then maybe you do need another dip in that fountain filled with blood. Amen. Why? Because this salvation, this grace, teaches us to deny worldly lusts and ungodliness, to purify ourselves. For Jesus died to redeem us and set us free from lawless deeds and filled us with a passion that makes us want to be a blessing. Hallelujah. That's grace. And then just in case Titus was scared to preach that, he finished that little passage with verse 15. Speak these things. Exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you. What's that mean? Stand up and tell people to straighten up and don't apologize. Amen. Amen. For he has redeemed us not only from the law, but from lawlessness. How did that work? By changing us on the inside. Hallelujah. This better sacrifice, this precious blood, obtains a better salvation, not just on the outside, but on the inside. The blood of bulls and goats could never remove the consciousness of sin. But he said that this salvation removes the consciousness of sin. The blood of Jesus purchased a redemption that cleanses our conscience from sin. Hallelujah. It doesn't just cleanse our guilt. We're no longer conscious of sin. We don't walk around every day thinking, is that a sin or is this a sin or have I sinned accidentally? Let the blood of Jesus remove from you the consciousness of sin. Become conscious of God instead of conscious of sin. The lack of consciousness of our sin and our failures allows us to enter into the very presence of God. That's what he's talking about here. Entrance into the real, live, heavenly, holy of holies. Because the blood of Jesus Christ has redeemed us both from the law that convicted us and the lawless deeds that caused us to be condemned. Both of those have been washed away. And we can enter into his holy presence, genuinely worshiping him without fear nor shame. Not just going through the motions, but worshiping him in spirit and in truth. Not because somebody's whipping us from behind, but because we love him dearly and we want to express our love and gratitude to him with all of our heart. Amen? We worship out of love and gratitude, not fear and neediness. We didn't come to beg and we didn't come to grovel. We came to love on the one who paid our price. Hallelujah. Let's stand up. Well, if that didn't help you, you're dead. There's no hope for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. No, there's always hope for you. Why? Because the eternal price has been paid, and for those who receive it, it's always available. Everybody say, receive it. Receive. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I only got about a third of the way I thought I was going to get tonight, but it was good anyway, wasn't it? Amen. That'll cut down on my prep time for next week. Amen. Hallelujah. Lift your hands up and just thank him. Thank him for the grace of God that brought salvation to all men and has been made available to all. Thank him that the eternal redemption price has been paid, that you're free from the consciousness of sin, you're free from lawless deeds and from the law that pointed out and made you feel condemned about it. free from both, free to love, free to worship, free to receive that which has already been bought and paid for. Oh, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, for paying the price for me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me grace, not just to believe, but grace to receive in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. I'll wrap my faith around it right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I've got a hold of it right now, and I'll not turn it loose. Oh, no. Oh, no. For the heavenly Holy of Holies has been opened up to me, and I can come boldly into the throne room of grace and receive mercy and grace to help for every single need. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I worship you and praise you and glorify your holy name. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for these precious people came out tonight. They've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. They've been set free from the law and from lawless deeds. They're walking in righteousness and true holiness, for that is indeed who they are because of whose they are. And now I commit them to your care. Watch over them carefully, won't you? In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen.